Good afternoon. Welcome back to Wolf of Asgard Hobbies. If you're a new viewer, welcome to Wolf of Asgard Hobbies. I am your host, Kyle. Today, we'll be talking about an elite group of fighters known for their tracking, marksmanship, survival skills, and swiftness. Here are your timestamps. Lead the way. Frontiersman who would serve in the British Army during the French Indian War, who would also serve with the British again during the American War of Independence after George Washington refused his service. Given the rank of major, Roger Roberts would be charged with forming, training, and commanding a rapidly deployable corps of light infantry tasked mainly with reconnaissance, using skirmishing and guerrilla tactics with light infantry units. This corps of light infantry would be known as the Rangers. The Rangers would use a large number of European weapons, such as the Brown Bess or the Kentucky Rifle, but they would also use Native American weapons, such as the Tomahawk and War Club. They didn't have any professional uniform, but they wore a lot of green, brown, black, and even Native American clothing, such as moccasins, or sometimes even the gun sashes they had would have Native American beading on them. Outside of training the Rangers, Robert Rogers would also write the rules to ranging, which, if I remember correctly, are still used today by the United States Army's Rangers. 28 rules are: Rule 1. All Rangers are to be subject to the rules and articles of war, to appear at roll call every evening on their own parade, equipped each with a firelock, 60 rounds of powder and ball, and a hatchet, at which time an officer from each company is to inspect the same to see that they are in order, so as to be ready on any emergency to march at a minute's warning, and before they are dismissed, and the necessary guards are to be drawn, and the scouts for the next day appointed. Rule 2. Whenever you are ordered out to the enemy's fort or frontiers for discovery, if your number be small, march in a single file, keeping at such a distance from each other as to prevent one shot killing two men, sending one man or more forward, and the like on each side at the distance of 20 yards from the main body, if the ground you march over will admit of it, to give signal to the officer of the approach of an enemy and of their number. Rule 3. If you march over marshes or soft ground, change your position and march abreast of each other to prevent the enemy from tracking you as they would do if you marched in single file, till you get over such ground, and then resume your former order and march till it is quite dark before you encamp, which do, if possible, in a piece of ground which that may afford your sentries the advantage of seeing or hearing the enemy some considerable distance, keeping one half of your whole party awake, alternating through the night. Rule 4. Sometime before you come to the place you would reconnoiter, make a stand and send one or two men in whom you can confide to look out the best ground for making your observations. Rule 5. If you have the good fortune to take any prisoners, keep them separate till they are examined, and in your return, take a different route from that in which you went out, that you may the better discover any party in your rear and have any opportunity, if their strength be superior to yours, to alter your course or disperse as circumstances may require. Rule 6. If you march in a large body of 300 or 400 with a design to attack the enemy, divide your party into 3 columns, each headed by a proper officer, and let those columns march in single files. The column to the right and left, keeping at 20 yards or more from that of the center, if the ground will admit, and let proper guards be kept, in the front and rear, and suitable flanking parties at due distance as before directed, with orders to halt on all eminences, to take view of the surrounding ground, to prevent your being ambuscaded, and to notify the approach or retreat of the enemy, that proper dispositions may be made for attacking, defending, and if the enemy approach in your front on level ground, form a front of your 3 columns or main body with the advancing guard, keeping out your flanking parties as if you were marching under the command of a trusty officer, to prevent the enemy from pressing hard on either of your wings or surrounding you, which is the usual method of the savages if their numbers will admit of it, and be careful likewise to support and strengthen your rear guard. Rule 7. If you are obligated to retrieve the enemy's fire, fall and squat down till it is over, then rise and discharge at them. If their main body is equal to yours, extend yourselves occasionally, but if superior, be careful to support and strengthen your flanking parties, to make them equal to theirs, that if possible you may repulse them to their main body, in which case push upon them with the great resolution and equal force in each flank and in the center, observing to keep at a due distance from each other, and advance from tree to tree with one half of the party before the other 10 or 12 yards. If the enemy pushes upon you, let your front fire and fall down, and then let your rear advance through them, and do the like, by which time those who before were in front will be ready to discharge again, and repeat the same alternately as occasions shall require. By this means you will keep up such a constant fire that the enemy will not be able to easily break your order or gain the ground. Rule 8. If you oblige the enemy to retreat, be careful in your pursuit of them, to keep out your flanking parties and prevent them from gaining eminences or rising grounds, in which case they would perhaps be able to rally and repulse you in their turn. Rule 9. If you are obliged to retreat, let the front of your whole party fire and fall back till the rear hath done the same, making for the best ground you can. By this means you will oblige the enemy to pursue you, if they do it at all, in the face of a constant fire. Rule 10. If the enemy is so superior that you are in danger of being surrounded by them, let the whole party disperse and everyone take a different road to the place of rendezvous appointed for that evening, which must every morning be altered and fixed for the evening ensuing, in order to bring the whole party, or as many of them as possible, together after any separation that may happen in the day. But if you should happen to be actually surrounded, form yourselves into a square, or if in the woods, a circle is best, and if possible, make a stand till the darkness of night favors your escape. Rule 11. If your rear is attacked, the main body and flankers must face about to the right or left as occasion shall require, and form themselves to oppose the enemy as before directed, and the same method must be observed if attacked in either of your flanks, by which means you will always make a rear of one of your flank guards. Rule 12. If you determine to rally after retreat, in order to make a fresh stand against the enemy, by all means endeavor to do it on the most rising ground you come at, which will give you greatly the advantage and point of situation, and enable you to repulse superior numbers. Rule 13. In general, when pushed upon by the enemy, reserve your fire till they approach very near, which will then put them into the greatest surprise and concentration, and give you an opportunity of rushing upon them with your hatchets and cutlasses to the better advantage. Rule 14. When you encamp at night, fix your sentries in such a manner as not to be relieved from the main body till morning, profound secrecy and silence being often of the last importance in these cases. Each sentry, therefore, should consist of 6 men, 2 of whom must be constantly alert, and when relieved by their fellows, it should be done without noise, and in case those on duty see or hear anything which alarms them, they are not to speak, but one of them is silently to retreat and acquaint the commanding officer thereof, that proper dispositions may be made, and all occasional sentries should be fixed in a like manner. Rule 15. At the first dawn of day, awake your whole detachment, that being the time when the savages choose to fall upon their enemies, you should by all means be in readiness to receive them. Rule 16. If the enemy should be discovered by your detachments in the morning, and their numbers are superior to yours, and a victory doubtful, you should not attack them till evening, as they will not know your numbers, and if you are repulsed, your retreat will be favored by the darkness of the night. Rule 17. Before you leave your encampment, send out small parties to scout round it, to see if there be any appearances or track of an enemy that might have been near you during the night. Rule 18. When you stop for refreshments, choose some spring or rivulet, if you can, and dispose your party so as not to be surprised, posting proper guards and sentries at a due distance, and let a small party lay away the path you came in, lest the enemy should be pursuing. Rule 19. If in your return you have to cross rivers, avoid the usual fords as much as possible, lest the enemy should have discovered and be there expecting you. Rule 21. If you have to pass by lakes, keep at some distance from the edge of the water, lest in case of an ambuscade or an attack from the enemy, when in the situation, your retreat should be cut off. Rule 21. If the enemy pursue you near, take a circle till you come to your own tracks, and there form an ambush to receive them and give them the first fire. Rule 22. When you return from a scout and come near our forts, avoid the usual roads and avenues thereto, lest the enemy should have headed you and lay in ambush to receive you when almost exhausted with fatigues. Rule 23. When you pursue any party that has been near our forts or encampments, follow not directly in their tracks, lest they should be discovered by their rear guards, who at such a time would be most alert, but endeavor by a different route to head and meet them in some narrow pass, or lay in ambush to receive them when and where they least expect it. Rule 24. If you are to embark in canoes, bateaux, or otherwise by water, choose the evening for the time of your embarkation, as you will then have the whole night before you to pass undiscovered by any parties of the enemy on hills or other places which command a prospect of the last or river you are upon. Rule 25. In paddling or rowing, give orders that the boat or canoe next to the sternmost wait for her, and the third for the second, and the fourth for the third, and so on, to prevent separation, and that you may be ready to assist each other on any emergency. Rule 26. Appoint one man in each boat to look out for the fires on the adjacent shores, from the numbers and size of which you may form some judgment of the numbers that kindled them, and whether you are able to attack them or not. Rule 27. If you find the enemy encampment near the banks of a river or lake, which you imagine they will attempt to cross for their security upon being attacked, leave a detachment of your party on the opposite shore to receive them. Well, with the remainder, You surprise them, having them between you and the lake or river. Rule 28. If you cannot satisfy yourself as to the enemy's number and strength from their fire, conceal your boats at some distance and ascertain their numbers by a reconnoitering party. When they embark or march in the morning, mark the course they steer, when you may pursue, ambush, and attack them, or let them pass as prudence shall direct you. In general, however, that you may not be discovered by the enemy upon the lakes and rivers at a great distance, it is safest to lay by with your boats and party concealed all day without noise or shoe, and to pursue your intended route by night, and whether you go by land or water, give out parole and countersigns in order to know one another in the dark, and likewise appoint a station every man to repair to in case of any accident that may separate you.
I could make this video on Robert Rogers and his Rangers, but what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to talk about a different Ranger group that were formed in the 1850s.
Only 2 years after the Gold Rush, September 9th, 1850, territory to the west would become the 31st state, the Golden State, the state of California. In May 1853, California Governor John Bigler would appoint a retired Army veteran and former Texas Ranger in charge of a volunteer group responsible with killing or capturing a gang who had a hand in over 20 murders, numerous robberies, and horse theft in Gold County, California. This gang was the Five Joaquins Gang. The man Governor Bigler appointed was Harry Love. Harry Love, born in 1810 Vermont, left home at an early age to become a sailor. Harry would move to Texas and become a Texas Ranger. Later, the Rangers would be mustered into a federal service with the U.S. Army. Harry Love would fight in the Mexican-American War as a scout, Army Express rider, and would lead an expedition of the Rio Grande. In 1850, retired Army Captain Harry Love would move to California to try his luck as a gold miner, but was unsuccessful. He would then move to Santa Barbara in 1852 to work as a deputy sheriff and as a bounty hunter.
After being appointed the head of California's first statewide law enforcement agency, Captain Harry Love would recruit 20 men into a group that was considered part of the California militia, which is the precursor to the California National Guard, and this group would be known as the California Rangers.
Like other ranger groups at the time, such as the Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, and Colorado Rangers, Rangers were required to equip themselves, but even their equipment had to meet certain standards. One of the standards was you must have a brace of pistols or revolvers, a large caliber rifle, a horse that can go many miles on minimum feed and water, and then we'll get into equipment later. So some of the weapons I have in front of me, we're going to start with our melee weapons, would be a tomahawk. And if you remember, tomahawk is an Algonquin word, meaning to knock down. And if you remember the first rule of Rogers' rules to ranging, you were to have 60 shots of powder and ball and a hatchet. So even though he says hatchet, he's actually referring to the tomahawk. Now, designed by Rizin, R-E-Z-I-N, Bowie, brother to Jim Bowie, who had this knife designed and made for him, and this knife would become famous as a dueling knife during the Sandabar battle. Now in 1780, the trapper pistol was produced. It's a single shot per flintlock pistol with finger grip, finger groove, finger hook, or extra grip, so you can have them, so it's much more stable in the hand. If you still remember me firing, I didn't like it from here. It's just a touch too heavy, but right here it sits just right and it's far more stable. This is a flintlock. Most flintlocks by the year of 1830 would be converted into a percussion lock. right here we have the Kentucky pistol, which the Kentucky pistol design itself dates back to the American Revolution and even beforehand, because these were designed after the German police pistol in, well, Germany. In 1830, they'd be converted to a percussion cap. This is also a 50 caliber. In 1851, Samuel Colt would design an open-frame Colt revolver, though not this one. Unfortunately, I don't have the one they're talking about. At 7.5 inches, or Army cavalry length, and because I only have one of these, and it's not of the proper length, I will not be using it for this video. In 1823, Samuel Hawking in St. Louis would design the Hawking rifle. This one has a finger hook as well for a much sturdier grip. Just double set trigger. So you have your sensitivity trigger and your fire trigger. They were designed in both percussion cap and flintlock, but again, by 1830, they would be predominantly flintlock. Famous for their reliability, they were labeled as the gun that helped win the West. But if you couldn't afford a new rifle or you couldn't afford a percussion cap, Daddy's or Grandpa's Kentucky rifle from the 1700s would just have to work. This is also 50 caliber, double set trigger, flintlock. It's not the most unreliable weapon, but compared to other weapons such as the Hawkings, it is definitely has something to be desired. In 1850, Ezekiel Baker would import several English-styled shotguns to the U.S. in 1850 by Ezekiel Baker, who was a gunsmith in London. These would see more use during the Civil War. This is single trigger, double two hammers, double barrel 20-gauge shotgun, and it's not my favorite. Right here we have another Kentucky rifle with another invention from the 1830s. However, my scope is not historically accurate, though rifle scopes or telescopic scopes have been around since 1830. The Malcolm Leatherwood scope wouldn't be produced until 1855, 2 years after the California Rangers would disband. It's 6x magnification. It's pretty reliable, although I haven't dropped it, and I don't plan to drop it. It was a very expensive purchase on my part. We also have a couple muskets. Right here is an 1853 or P53, pattern 53, infilled musket rifle in 58 caliber percussion cap. These would be imported from England. We also have another musket, which will get its own video. This is the Brown Bess. It's been in service since 1722. Quick overview, it's been in 14 different, served 14 different nations, has 7 different variations, and has fought in 44 different wars. This is 75 caliber, but we'll be using 69 caliber as a means of quicker loading. So, with the weapons out of the way, let's get into some of the equipment that the Rangers expected you to carry. For equipment, we have a means to make fire. Knife, fork, spoon, plate, cooking pan with foldable, or if back in the day it would probably have been detachable handle. Percolator as a means to either make coffee or purify water. Canteen to store it in. Ammo box. Now it says you should carry 100 rounds of ammunition, and here's a little trick for you. Rangers, cowboys, banditos, people at that time more than likely would carry a rifle and a pistol in the same caliber. That way it's less ammo for the carry, but at the same time it's in more quantity. That way, you know, you're carrying either all 357 or all 44. That way you're not carrying only half 44, half 357, or half 36, half 50 cal. It's all one caliber, which would, you know, gradually help you. You'd also have a wool blanket, possibly a tarp. Not a tarp, a canvas tent. That's what I was looking for. Like a tarp, that wasn't right. And then your food, you'd bring beans, bacon, rice,
sugar, salt, and if you're making coffee, a cup to put that in when you're done. And if you ever ran out of provisions, that's where, you know, tracking came in, because now you have to survive off the land to meet your caloric intake. So with equipment and weapons out of the way, let's go into tactics.
Okay, so this looks like a hot mess, but where Roger Roberts' Rangers were unconventional light infantry, it is best to think as the California Rangers or the Texas Rangers or even the Arizona Rangers as a unconventional dragoon force, a type of mounted cavalry, well, not mounted cavalry, mounted infantry. They would ride into a skirmish with their horses, dismount, and then engage as infantry, hence dragoon, mounted infantry. Yeah, so what we have here looks like a hot mess, but we have the Rangers in green, and the, we'll just call it the five Joaquins gang in blue. We have one trying to run away, he's being pursued by two Rangers on horseback. We have three Rangers here riding in an echelon formation at this, at this section here. As you can see, these two are no longer in cover because they're in front of the log. This one no longer has cover. This one does. These three do. And it looks like these infantrymen are about to shoot their buddies in the side. Well, actually, these are the same people. This person rode up, discharged his rifle or pistol, jumped off, then got behind a tree. And then so did this person. And this person. So now they've dismounted off their horses. Now they are engaging as unconventional infantry. And that is the quickest, most basic way I can run that down past you. Here we have a majority of the Ranger forces. They have dismounted, which we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 behind the trees. These seven didn't see them dismount or didn't hear them sneak up into position. Then we have three Rangers right here behind some concealment, waiting for a signal. So like more like for something to go wrong, like maybe there's gunfire or loud yelling, and then these three would ride up into the skirmish and then either dismount and engage them that way, or shoot, go around them and get behind the trees, and then dismount and engage them from the left side. So here we have our dragoons doing what was supposed to be a line charge. They obviously didn't stay in pace with each other, so it kind of broke. But they're still going to charge these seven here. And just imagine how terrifying that is. You and your buddies are laughing, having a good time, talking about the score you just got. And on next thing all you hear is a lot of whooping. And then hoof steps getting louder and louder and louder. And when you turn around, there's a wall of people charging you. So those three should give you a kind of basic idea on how Ranger tactics worked, or at least how they were supposed to operate. So let's put a couple of them into practice. We'll both do an infantry, a cavalry, and then a dragoon, or at least as best as I can do it. So let's troubleshoot our percussion lock, just in case when you're in the field there's an event of misfire. First things first though, this firearm is unloaded, but what is rule number one? Treat all firearms as if they're loaded. Then what's rule number two? Check and confirm. So, I have no cap on the nipple. And I have no charge in the barrel. So the firearm is in fact empty, and now all you know that. Similar to the flintlock, we're going to put the in half cock, and we're going to blow down the barrel, make sure there's no blockage in the bolster pan or in the nipple. So you'll know this if you'll feel air on your finger, or you'll hear it. Alright, so I hear air, feel air. This is the thing in the bolster or nipple. But let's say for some weird reason, you ram a cartridge down, you put a cap on, you squeeze the trigger,
The only thing that goes off is the cap. You wait your 10 seconds, put another cap on, and the same thing happens. So, what we want to do is simple. All we're going to do is take the nipple off. Then once the nipple is off, you're going to look down it, see if you see any light. There you go. You're going to look in your bolster. And as you see, there is no powder in there. So what you're going to do is you're going to take your pick. You're going to fish around in there for a bit. Again, at an angle. And because there's nothing in there or blocking it, my needle has no problem going as far. So then you're going to add just a touch of powder into the bolster pen. Yeah, that'd be correct because this is the chamber. So the bolster chamber. Put your nipple back on. Nipple back on. Now there was another trick I heard of. You know, fill your bolster pen and for extra certainty, I don't recommend this, however. According to historic reports, when people back in the 1800s and possibly even 1700s, because 1830s when percussion locks were a thing, they would take a little powder, put it on their finger, and then scrape that into the nipple, which, so when the cap explodes, it ignites the powder in the nipple, which will ignite the powder in the bolster, which then will ignite the main charge and discharge the firearm. Alright, so that's how you would troubleshoot your flintlock if you're having issues out in the field.
Alright, so here we are on the hill. My rifle's loaded. I did that off screen. I have a target set up there, 100 yards, and we're going to snipe it. Now, sniping is shooting a particular target. Sharpshooting is shooting targets of interest. So, like, if you shoot random people at far distances, that's sharpshooting. You only shoot one person at far distance, that's sniping. So I'm going to snipe the target, and we're going to see if I can hit it. All right, let's go. My scope is not sighted in, so if I hit it, that will be impressive. Three. Two. One. Firing. Alright, so this time I loaded up my Hawking rifle. I'm going to try to shoot the 100 yard target again. And then I'm going to try to shoot the 80 and the 20 in the next scene. Alright, trying again. Right above it. Alright, inhale. Next two targets. Alright, this one's at the 80. I'm in the kneeling position. Second trigger. Full cock. Alright, standing on the 20. Full cock. Right next to it. Okay, so, alright, both my pistols are loaded. I'm gonna stand next to the camera, shoot the balloon at the 20, move up 20 paces, no, 30 paces, because that'll put the 80 target, the 80 yard target in the 50 yard range. So, let's do that. Alright, right handed, 20 yards, standing, right above it. Let's move up 30 yards and try to hit the 81. Okay, here we go. 30 yards, no, 50 yards. Left-handed. Right here, left-handed. Right under it. Okay, so let's move both of them at the 7 and see if I can hit them at the 7. All right, so I'm gonna move up to the 7 yard line. I'm going to shoot the right one with my right pistol, and I'm going to shoot the left one with my left pistol. So, 7 yards. So, let's count the score, shall we? Long distance, scoped, 100 yards, miss. Rifle, 180, 20, miss. Pistols, 50, 20, 2 and 7, missed. That's just depressing. After Captain Harry Love would kill notorious Five Joaquins bandit, Joaquin Moretta, I think that's right, they would later on kill another member of the Five Joaquins gang, whose name I forgot, but I'll throw their name up in the notes. They would carry Joaquin Moretta's head and this other bandit's hand in to collect the bounty. And in August 1853, they would disband. But their roles and responsibilities will live on through the California Highway Patrol, California Department of Justice, and California Bureau of Investigation. Under President Erdős in the year 2161, the California Rangers would be reestablished by a man named Seth. But that is a story for another time.
Yippee-yay, there'll be no wedding bells for today. I got spurs that jingle, jangle, jingle,
jingle, jangle,
as I go riding merrily along.
Jingle, jangle,
hey, sing, oh, ain't you glad you're single?
Jingle, jangle,
and that song ain't so very far from wrong.
Jingle, jangle,
oh, Lily Bell,
oh, Lily Bell,
oh, Lily Bell,
oh, Lily Bell.
Though I may have done some fooling, this is why I never fell. Cause I got spurs.
Well, look, too, they got a car to work. The ball out in Vegas, they mentioned the New California Republic was just as warm as the world's keeping trucks working. Pull out four, they got Raiders and figure out how to mount metal to power armor and integrate their helmet systems into it.
And that song,
so it's too much to ask that they figure out how to get a motor like wrong. Modernish firearms. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope I was able to teach you something. And until our next project, have a beautiful day.
I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the like button. If you have any suggestions or criticism, comment. And if you want to stay tuned for my next project, don't forget to click that subscribe icon and ring that bell. So, until our next project, have a beautiful day.
Ain't you glad you're single?
Oh, ain't you glad you're single?